Also so aus, das Schwarz ist es vor. Du hustest dem Leben ein. You say in German, you cough on life. Because you're preparing yourself for getting into a coffin. It's already preparing the body. There will be no air in the last home of the body. There will be worms, but they will not make mouse-to-mouse reanimation. I need, this is my reanimation coffee. So, how much preparation one needs. Exact 10 o'clock. Germany. Romana needs flowers? God flowers. Garland. Google's garden. So, welcome to the next quiz show. Many, but here the quiz master get questioned, not the candidates. So good, everyone knows. You want to start? No, here. Before you, the one before you.
Only
you are from?
England.
England.
Yes. I'm here to listen.
You're here to listen?
Maybe I'll have a question later.
Okay. That's I'm used to. Not yet. It's always a question. Not yet. Not yet. Not yet. Are you ready? Not yet. Okay, then the Germany behind England.
It's a rare thing.
Normally Germans always have to run in front. It's a frontier. They always frontier, frontier. Soldiers running for the frontier, being on the front. So Germany.
Yesterday there was something happening which made me know, gave me a question. Ah. Like I met by coincidence, I met another satsang teacher.
No.
Just one popped up.
There was a fisherman out fishing. It's called fisherman fishing.
I wasn't really waiting to eat him.
But you were a fish for him to catch.
Ah, yeah, maybe. I don't know.
No, he is a fisherman. You were a fish.
Okay. So I was a fish, but I met him in a coffee shop, and then I started to feel like a mosquito from a meditator. Because I really tried, not I tried, but I didn't agree with him, and I start to say things. I think he was a bit unpleased with it.
Oh.
And but he's like, I was allowed to be angry, but he was already enlightened, so he didn't get angry.
Yeah.
And
he could not show it.
Came to a point where now I have a question out of it, because I was talking about that I don't believe in another state of consciousness is more real, but I don't know why, but when it's happened already before I came here, to me I always asked who is realizing this unreality, is it still me? And he said, and then I said, when I feel that very strong, it's painful and I'm afraid of dying. That's what I told him. He said, dying is just another identification of your mind, and if you're free of this identification, that's what you are. I don't agree, but still, in his construction of logic, it's okay.
That's why it's called a satsang teacher. There's something to do, otherwise there would be no teacher. So the mind has to be destroyed, that you can be free. So depending on the absence of the mind, that's where the teacher's living from.
All right.
You have to overcome the ego, or whatever, you have to destroy the ego, and only without the ego you can be what you are. That's a teaching. Otherwise, if that would be not needed, that the ego can stay or not, no one cares. What is there to teach? They can only teach something, some techniques to overcome something, like having a recipe for a disease. But in this sense, if I sit here and tell you what you are, it was never sick, and so it never needs to be healed, then there's no remedy needed or anything. Nothing can be done and needs to be done. So, but a teacher needs some goal. And the goal is being, it calls a natural state, being without an ego. But for me, natural state is not knowing what is natural or non-natural. And then ego or no ego, who cares about an ego or not ego? So that your nature is not depending on any absence or presence. But whatever self who is depending on an absence of an ego is still a relative one. That you can, it's like an advantage, but only relative self needs an advantage. The absolute advantage of the self itself, it's not needing one. So the absolute advantage is that what you are, there's no idea about disadvantage and poor advantage. But that what has can have an advantage, I agree, it's an advantage having no ego. But who needs it? There's a very subtle me still running. Yeah. A me who has an advantage of an absence of a me. And then this teacher calls himself no me. Some of them.
You know, I told him actually that, and then he said, I just have to make the experience he had made, otherwise I can't judge
it. Okay. So he realized his true nature.
I told him that I don't believe in it. But
yeah.
He said,
no, then I would just have, you just wish him good luck. Mm-hmm. Be happy and just don't bother about it. Let him be in his true, whatever. He calls true nature or truth or anything, because it's just another concept. Let him be happy in this concept of no me. Be generous, because what you are can be very generous, because you can be generous to everyone, even to yourself. No, this is the nature of what you are. You are the acceptance itself, and there's nothing what you have to deny. So you renounce whatever can be renounced, even renunciation you renounce, whatever. There's nothing to be done for what you are. And the rest is just part of the dream. Let him be a dream phantom awakened, and having a dream experience where the dream phantom from a personal phantom became an impersonal phantom. Oh, congratulations. Well done, baby. You made it. Now you have to behave like one. Another prison. Now you cannot have emotions anymore. You cannot be angry anymore. All of that.
It's very fun, huh?
Yeah, it's very funny. You're really in a prison of, you have to be cool, baby. Nothing can touch you. I had this experience, what I am cannot be touched, so I now have to live it. This is really like an idea, you have to live what you are. As if that one has a standard, a preference, or how it is living itself. Fantastic, right? So what to do? So as what you are, as I said, you can be totally generous about everything. You can run or not, and they can be realized or not. Okay, you're realized. Wonderful, congratulations, see you next time. When your realization drops again. So what to do? Michael? Sleep. Keep sleeping. No, again, that knowledge of you is independent of any water. It's never been experienced, it's never any whatever you can claim. There is no claiming in it. And when there is one who claims that he has an experience and seeing you as one who has no experience, he is still in this dual dream of more or less, or advanced or disadvanced, and I made it, you didn't make it. It's a game of consciousness. Let it play. Olympic game of consciousness, who is more awakened? And who is more realized? So you can be generous, just enjoy the show, because it will always be like an Olympic game of, and like an awakened one get a gold medal. Then running around like a medal of honor. I made it, and then he will be full of flowers like me here. become a fool of flowers. Yeah, I can say I don't mind, but I would never ask for it. I appreciate it. Because this is I like, actually.
No, because as soon as I pick it, they killed it. It's the most ridiculous thing to pick because they're beautiful where they, you know, are. As soon as you pick them, so anybody who buys one of these people is just stupid.
English. He's here with all the British luck he needs.
Yeah.
You're British. What does it mean, actually? I always ask when I meet one from England, what does it bloody mean that I wish you all the British luck or something? All of the British luck.
I think it means fuck off.
That's the best answer. That's the best answer. Just leave me alone. Find out. I wish you all the best of British luck. But leave me alone. Fuck. Well, that's good. That I would call every teacher who crosses my way. I wish you all the best of British luck. Just leave me alone. So Spain, something new?
Nothing. I think all the rain has come here instead of Spain.
I hope so.
Yeah.
Rain doesn't need Spain. Rain doesn't need Spain.
Rain go to Spain. Rain go to Spain. You know that?
No. The Germans take it all. Yeah, it will be desert in Spain, as you know. Mm-hmm. Half of Spain will be desert. It's prediction. You are in the climate change. Mm-hmm. But you are fighting for it. I always like that people fight for the climate change. Or against it? What was it? Yeah.
Can you say something about listening?
Listening?
Yes, because I experienced that there are different levels.
Yeah.
It's me hearing my story.
Hearing is with hearing.
Listening.
No, but listening is not with ears. You listen with space. Listening is like a space perception. And the hearing is with your ears. And by hearing you want to understand something. But listening is just listening without expecting something of useful information. Hearing you are giving attention to useful information, what you can. But listening is just like to music. You just enjoy the music. Then you listen. That is enjoying yourself. Listening is like meditation, you don't expect some results. In hearing, if you are really, then you expect some information what you are useful for later, what you are, whatever you want to control.
So my experience is that when I listen with my ears, it's my whole story comes
then
in.
Then it's hearing.
Yeah, it's hearing.
Because that's why you get earrings, it's heavy. heavy earrings by hearing. Because
but there was a
golden earring.
Yeah. But the listening is what you say about.
It's like meditation more.
Meditation. So like listening. When I'm here, so something happens which I cannot control.
Then maybe listening happens because this is like a song of irrelevance. Yeah. The song of irrelevance is like puts you in the listening, and the listening is enjoying yourself as you are. Actually, it's maybe you can call it your natural being without expecting something coming out of what you're doing or not doing, because there's no doership in it. But when you're hearing, you want to make it, you want to employ it for later.
So it's a shift all the time.
It's a shift of perception from a controller, caretaker, to that word is just listening. It's like the living words. When the living words, you listen, then the listening and what is listened to is not different in nature. So that was the loudspeaker and the microphone, there is no speaker and no microphone inside. Then it's just like a living words without any results or intention. That they call it meditation. Active meditation.
Yeah.
So life in action without expecting to get more or less life out of it. Then it's like an art, the moose is kissing you and you're just enjoying yourself. Because you are not, you're just, you don't know even what you're doing or not. Just not knowing is the Tao, is then just there. But when you expect something, then you're out of it. So you're out of it by expectation and you are that what you are without. So what do you do?
But there was a famous, I don't know, remember who it was, psychologist or someone in the psychiatric field, who talked about listening with a third ear.
Yeah, that's even in the German music group called Third Ear. Very esoteric group.
German. Ask Behrens. I think Behrens.
So what
do you think he meant by that? Listening,
it's like the third eye. The third eye and the third ear.
Listening with a third ear. What do you think he meant by that?
Yeah, he meant like that in that listening there is no expectation. Like the third ear is not hearing something. It's just like an open back door. It's like an open front and open back door. It's just like a breeze goes through you without anyone who wants to grab something and find some useful information in it or something. And that is just like an open back door. So the me is just like the fear putting the back door closed that you then a storage happens.
But sometimes when you, I mean, I've experienced in the past, when you listen, 30 or whatever you want to call it, you hear what a person is saying beyond what they're conscious of saying. What's that?
You listen to that word, it's not the person, you're listening to that where it comes from. And that is not different from what you are, so it's already no difference in nature. Then you understand by understanding, but not by relative understanding. There's an understanding beyond words, which is already there before even he says something. So you understand because there's, you already know what he means before he even opens his mouth. It's just like a silent understanding. That's very often, you know already.
The speaker often doesn't understand what he means.
No, he doesn't need to. But as if you can offend me by saying I know what I say, that would be an offense. So I never know what I say. It just if I were to think before I speak, it would be different. So in that sense, like this is like a river of carelessness, and there's a carelessness of listening. This carelessness is the only what is called good company.
I'm not talking about you, though. I'm talking about.
No, I mean like but, it would be carelessness.
It doesn't happen with you, yeah. No, it doesn't happen with you, but it's with a person less conscious, less aware of himself, of anything.
Well, you're very familiar with someone, and, whatever. So many different ways of, and between that. And this is the extreme that, and then between there is all grace and until the whatever. But the making a difference again is already part of the dream.
Yeah.
So that is, we can talk about it, but thanks God it makes no difference.
Yeah.
Because it's just for entertainment, that you maybe know something, but you can just drop it again. It's like a dust spin. So we are all living by differences. And no way out. So life is living itself in differences. And even there are differences in hearing and listening and all of that. But again, I can only say for what you are, it makes no difference. Never made any difference to what you are. So you don't get more what you are when you are listening, and you are not less when you are hearing. And you have no choice anyway.
When so when you're talking, is it the same difference? Like your hearing is...
I shift permanently between everything.
How do you call this? When you sometimes I talk and I'm wondering what I'm saying. Because
there is no speaker. There was never any speaker. There was never anyone who spoke one word. Consciousness is doing everything. Consciousness speaks, consciousness listening. The speaker is just a functioning of a me. Just after the word appears, it claims to be the speaker. But he has never spoken anything. It's just a functioning of claiming, of a story. He never did anything. There was never any doership or speakership or whatever. So the thinker is already a thought, a functioning of a thought who claims that he thought something. But the thinker already is a thought. No one can think. There is no thinker behind the thinker. The thinker is already a thought which claims to have thoughts. That's all. So let him claiming what is not his anyway, because that's always the case. The thinker claiming like having thoughts. Let him be happy if he likes it. Then he has a big collection of thoughts, like a cloud around him. In Germany, clouds means it's stolen already. It's a thief. They call him in India a thief, stealing all what is not his, and collecting something what is stolen from life. He becomes a thief, and then you catch him, and then he's like, okay, now I take care, I become a policeman. This will never happen again. So he will make, he wants your attention. Attention, please. Please, please, please. Please me. Even if you beat me up, please beat me. Hit me. But you have to be a real sadist. If the masochistic thinker comes and wants to be beaten up, he says, no. Good.
I agree.
No. Not you. Good. Still nothing from England?
Well, I'm aware this is my first day. I would ideally like to ask you, what's the big picture for you?
The big picture?
But I don't, these people will know already.
I would say the big picture, the big painting, is like you are the absolute painter who is not part of the picture. That's a big picture. So you are the absolute dreamer, which is not part of the dream. You are the absolute, the para-brahman, who cannot not be catched in his own dream. That's the big picture. So there's a small picture, like a little me, and the big picture, which is a cosmic me. Like the little consciousness and the big consciousness, which is cosmic. But even in the cosmic consciousness, you cannot catch yourself. So this is a game of consciousness between the little one and the big one. Always up and down, up and down. Always playing the intellect, the absolute intellect, and then the relative intellect, and my, and not, and owning, and not owning, all that game of consciousness. This is like your movie, but you are this absolute script writer, which is already not part of the script. So you now you have to, like a blueprint, you have to live, you have to experience that what you have written before, and your absolute potential, and you cannot get out of it, because you're not in it. You cannot not realize yourself as whatever, yes. That's the big picture I'm presenting. That there's no way to attaining what you are. And you will never know what you are or who you are. There's no way of knowing what you are. And that I say that the knowledge of what you are is, was, it is, and will be that what you are, which is, was uninterrupted, never needs any more information or less information. And the rest of this information game of images and things, they're there because you are. But you are not because of that. Whatever. But you cannot get rid of it because there is nothing. But you can get rid of, because you are the reality who cannot get rid of reality. And that, like the pointer is, like if this would be real, you cannot get rid of it. If it's not real, you don't have to. That's the only thing. So you can rest in any way. Just rest in what you are. As I said, if this is real, no way to get rid of it. If it's unreal, you don't have to. So who cares about if it's real or unreal? That's actually the direct pointer. There's not, you can be the laziest bastard you already are, because you have never done anything. So be the laziness itself, because that is what you are. What you are never, there is no doership in you, there is no action, there is no not action, there is not any idea in what you are. That's the nature of, that's jnana. This is a jnani who is jnana, because a jnani doesn't know any jnana anymore. So not knowing what is and what is not what you are. That is what you are. And that not knowing what you are and what you are not is already there. You don't have to work for it. So I'm here only for the laziest bastard you are. for yourself, and not for any teachings and giving practices or something. With none of that practices, by none of them you will attain what you are anyway, but you can try. And I'm just presenting you the absolute failure here, the self. Because the self will always fail to know itself. The Buddha will never know Buddha. That's Buddha's message. Buddha never walked the earth, and if you meet Buddha on the way, like he yesterday, kill him. By knowing there will never be any Buddha walking. There is no embodiment of self. The body, the self has never any form or non-form. Whatever you can imagine, the self is not. And whoever claims he is embodiment of truth, okay, be generous, let him be the truth. Why not? If he likes it. Huh? Not so bad. Look, there is one who knows truth. Oh, bravo! And he tells all his friends. Huh? It's good for a birthday party. There's only one night, and I'm the light. I'm celebrating my non-birthday today. Me, because I know I'm unborn, so even being the unborn is an idea. Imagine, the self is that what is unborn. So it has to be something to be. What a kind of self is that? Even to be the unborn, it has to exist. To be the unborn. But the self who needs to exist is still a fiction. The self doesn't even need to exist to be. So that what is the absolute being doesn't even need to be. That's called the absolute, this absolute paradox. But that what needs to be is already what? A dream. Relative, depending on some. That's why they made it the absolute, because the absolute existence doesn't need even to exist to exist. And that is too much for this little brain. It breaks, it's like a koan, you cannot break. What? I don't have to be, but that I cannot. No. So it breaks you instantly. Mm-hmm. It's not for you. But for what you are, no problem. That's why the koans are made for. Not Andrew Koan, but it's another koan. If Papaji people can see themselves in Andrew, then maybe they made it. No. It's too much. Too much to ask for. Good, some other questions?
Thank you.
Or some more?
So what's the advantage?
The absolute advantage
of understanding.
Yeah, the absolute advantage of being what you are is that you don't need one anymore.
You don't need
an advantage to be what you are. That's the absolute advantage.
Right.
Otherwise, it's always advantage becker. In the tennis, who is the best tennis player or something? Advantage becker, advantage, la la la, advantage. Ping pong, the ping pong of consciousness, so always needs an advantage point. I make my point. Oh, that's in point. The pointlessness is what you are, where all the points come from. But the pointlessness of life doesn't need to make a point to be what you are. So, what to do? So I present you the absolute advantage, the satisfaction you never need to be satisfied. So there will be no satisfaction for what you are. That's the absolute satisfaction, because that what you are never needs to be satisfied at all. So satisfaction is that not needing satisfaction. So you are the absolute freedom who doesn't need freedom. So you are free of freedom. You are the knowledge who doesn't need knowledge, because you are knowledge. You can do it with everything, but you don't know what is knowledge and what is not knowledge. That's the nature of knowledge. But that advantage, not knowing yourself, what you are, what you are not, is peace. Because that peace is uninterrupted. It's not depending on any relative peace of understanding or in a special circumstance of meditation or listening or hearing. All of that is relative peace you can enter. But the peace of what you are, never. Because it was never gone, you cannot get it back. So whatever peace otherwise is promised, peace off. It cannot deliver the peace you are, thanks God, and praise the Lord, just in case. I would say, praise the Lord, just in case, maybe this one. You never know, but you don't have to know, so you're just in case. So you meditate just in case, you do things just in case.
Come here just in case.
Just in case. You can get something. Yeah, just in case, it's all just in case. Not just in Bibab. Just in case. So you do everything you do is just in case. Because you can never be sure. And what you are never needs to be sure. That's... It just does that anyway. You do as if something comes out. Just in case. So always, everything is unpredictable. And there is no boredom in it. If everything is unpredictable. Every moment. You never know. You can never be sure. Everything can change any moment to the opposite, or whatever, or being or not being. Wow! What goes on? So if you don't know what is going on, wow! But even that is an advantage, you see, even that is relative. Fuck! Wow! Fuck! I have to destroy everything, I'm really bad. So bad. But the people come that everything gets destroyed and that they're happy that they don't pack something on top of their loaded concepts and whatever thing. So I always tell them I will minimize you to the max. Minimize, not maximize. The little mouse, not the big mouse. Okay, so, something else. Mini. Germany.
Germany is tired.
Tired? From the weather.
Perhaps.
Yeah, the weather is... The changes are too many. Depression, bit high, depression. Very depressive. For the body is really... So the sickness is more obviously that you have a body in that weather. Good. Stephen, nothing today.
So I could read a quote and see what you have to say about it, if you
okay.
like.
Okay, you can read it.
Yeah.
Okay, prove me that you can read.
It's from a book called Perfect Brilliant Stillness, which I mentioned to you once.
That one.
If you're going to do anything, do this. First figure out whether this waking up, this enlightenment, is really something you want. Do you really want to die? Do you really want for you not to exist and for living to continue? If it does, not as who you know and love as yourself, but as a hollow husk with impersonal consciousness blowing through it? Is this what you want? If this is what you want, then you are talking about waking up from...
You already lost me.
Oh, that was enough?
Huh?
That was enough?
No, I have no idea. It's too much. Too much if and when and this one.
Okay.
You already lost me. After the first sentence, I didn't...
You want me to start again?
No. I'm not a masochist. Whoa. All the do's and don'ts and if you and if not and then you have to then you have to make up your mind. Oh, yeah. What?
Well, the gist of it.
I said my math teacher never accepted this answer.
Which answer?
I'm not a masochist and following.
Yeah, but I'm not a student here. Of one has to answer some questions. If what I like it or not, but as I say, when I listen to it, I already hear a teacher and one who got something and found something and now he wants to show you something. And that I'm not interested in. For me, the ultimate medicine is not finding anything. And not having found something and you have to make up your mind and then you have to be ready for it or something. I have no idea. No, I go with Nisargadatta. The ultimate medicine is you may look just in case everywhere and by not finding yourself in anything, you just rest in that what can never be found. That's all. But it's not something what you found in a special place of any awareness state or something. I'm much too lazy for that. And then making up your mind, the mind you don't have, it's really too much. To what to do. So that's why all those books I never read anyway.
But you also have books?
Yeah, but I never read them. I don't have to read them. No, I never read. The only book half I had to, because I had to, in German, someone translated that Advaita Gita into German, like, and then I had to look through, and that was really painful. Boy, I really said that. Oh, fuck it. Now I have to destroy it again. No, it's I have no idea. For me, it's all dead words. I would say, like, Ranjit Maharaj, when he was asked about books, about masters, said, don't read books of dead masters because they're not even living ones. Because the self has no master. And there's no master of the self. And there is no one who made it ever, in my, as I say it. So but if you ask me, there was never anyone who was realized. As there was no unrealized one in the first place. And out of that absence or impossibility of one who is unenlightened, no one will become enlightened from that. So all there is a self, was, is, and will be, and the self is always reality and never needs any more or less realization, because it's that what is realizing itself uninterrupted. And that's only worth being. That's a treasure you are. That can never be treasured by any relative treasuring. To treasure yourself is being yourself, absolutely, doublessness. It's what the knowledge is, what you are, and not by any claiming something and mastering some whatever. So don't be a slave for that idea that you can master yourself. You will never master yourself, never ever. Because the idea that you can master yourself is slavery. I tell you, it's slavery. And you are the best master and the best slave. And I sit again here and tell you, who cares about being mastered by oneself? And who cares about being a slave on oneself? Not the self. The self is fine, always fine. So nothing happens. And even in that game of slavery, okay, being a slave of yourself, being raped of what you are or by what you are, so I'm raped by what I am. It feels like a rape waking up because it's not by choice. So it feels like a rape, so, but who is raping who? You are the raper, the raping what is raped. So what? And you cannot stop it. The lover, the loving and the beloved, and sometimes this love affair feels like a rape affair. So what? Still a love affair. So everything is wrong. I like it. Just in case. So I sit here, big painting, and I paint again and say, you have to realize yourself in discomfort. You cannot realize the comfort you are. You cannot realize the beauty you are. You cannot realize the truth you are. You cannot realize whatever this nominal existence you are. But any experience of what you are is phenomenal, and it's always a discomfort experience. The discomfort experience of being separated to your beloved. There is no other way of experiencing yourself. It will always be right. So what to do? And here's one of the rare guys that says you have to be in spite of the presence or absence of the phantom of what you are. The phantom you cannot kill, because and that phantom you experience is only the experiencer, and you cannot get rid of the experiencer, which is the beginning of realization, of realizing of what you are. There is no end to it. So you can only realize yourself in separation. And part of the separation is oneness, that's all. So where there is oneness, there is two-ness, and both are two ways of realizing yourself. So what to do? Good. Humid again. More coffee. I need to look into some darkness. Too much light around. Plop. Coffee break. So in Port in Brazil, there's a book. The best title, I think, it was The Next Sip of Coffee. Just The Next Sip of Coffee. Just the pointer that always the next will just be there. The next and the next. And you cannot escape what you are, and there will always be the next, whatever it is. No end of realizing yourself. And I think this moment you realize yourself infinite times before. And it will be here infinite times after this time. Because it's not coming and coming, it will not go and going. And this moment is as absolute as you are. Never born, never dies. This is life. And life has no end. And there will always be the next moment of life, and you are that. So what to do? No way out of being what you are. So be what you cannot not be, and you are fine. Because you don't know anymore what is fine and what is not fine. Good. Hallelujah. Again. But just in case. Spain, something more? No? Okay. Yeah?
So, in a word, you're just saying relax.
No, I don't think you don't even have to relax to be what you are. That is quite relaxing, no?
Right.
Because what you are is never tense. So that what you are cannot relax because it was never tense. That what needs to relax, even by being relaxed, is too tense.
Work quite hard at studying the Vedanta approach, tradition.
Yeah, I like it. I was reading all the Ramana books too, and all the Dadu Ams and all the disciples of Ramana, and yeah. I always enjoyed the background stories. Because I'm after rumors. I like rumors. Because from the Ramana Ashram you got also the positive rumors. Mm-hmm. And from some disciples from you get the negative rumors too. What Raman, maybe the ashram would not allow to be published. So that he was never like a peaceful guy in the morning at 3 o'clock in the kitchen. He was like beating up everyone like one is losing one piece of rice or something. He was a tyrant in the kitchen. So at 7 o'clock in the morning, he was already exhausted, peaceful, sitting. When the first Western disciples come, or the Brahmin who sleep in, they come, so they find a relaxed, peaceful Ramana, sitting there exhausted from the work in the kitchen, and then presenting him your opposite Ramana. But if you would ask the workers in the kitchen, is Ramana peaceful? They all feared him. There was a fear running that he was whatever, like a dervish in the kitchen. So everyone has a different picture of Ramana. But he himself had never any picture of himself. That what he said, what you call the body of this, what you call Ramana, is just a disease, like a sickness. And what I am cannot get rid of it. That's all. But he never claimed to know himself.
So your view with working at Vedanta, there's this idea you can know the self, you can't experience it. There's a way of constant discrimination, debate, all of that.
I'm here in the 1980 tradition. this undecided tradition. Actually, the middle path of Buddha means being undecided. That's neither. It's neither love or wisdom who can give you anything. Neither. Like Nisargadatta, love tells me I'm everything, wisdom tells me I'm nothing, and between that my life flows. So they always tell you something, they always want to give me attention. Ah, love, you're everything. Wisdom, you are nothing. You're everything, you are nothing. Always is between two, whatever, talking in your back like advisors. They want to make you, they just need your attention, because without your attention there is no love and there is no wisdom. So you are in spite of wisdom and in spite of love. But both tell you different stories. One tells you, you are everything, you are oneness, and the other one, you are nothing. You are not even nothing. This grumpy wisdom and the loving love. So the mama and the papa always in the back. The male and the female. The awareness, wisdom and the female oneness. Always fighting who is right. And you are neither nothing or everything. You have no idea what you are, what you know. But when you are nothing, you are not, you are, then you say, oh, when you are nothing, you are everything. But it's just like a, you feel it's not true. It's like, I'm nothing, I'm everything. You better don't know if you are nothing, sounds good. Everything sounds good too. Okay. Whatever you say, just be generous. Just agree with everything. Okay. I'm nothing, okay. So if the next teacher comes, you're nothing, yes, you're nothing. Another one comes and the master of heart master comes, you're everything. Yes, you're I'm everything. Okay. Okay. If you say so, then I don't have to think about it. I give all up to you. You define what I am. It's fine for me. So you can stay as the laziest bastard you are. Let consciousness define what you are, and just be what? Not even happy, because what you are doesn't need even to be happy. Wonderful, huh? I don't need to be happy to be. That's quite a release, I tell you. This bloody happiness is the biggest pain in the ass. And all these happy people on Facebook. Big competition of happiness. I woke up today and was so happy, and I'm still happy, and my soup is so happy, and my cake I bake is so happy. Happy, happy. And my dog is happy, because I am happy. So I'm radiating happiness around me. Everyone is happy, actually. Even the flowers talk to me, happy. I like crumpy old. Sad. Bastards.
Throw stones.
Who did it? The master of the mountain. The Swami of the mountain, but he's down now and he's gone. I think he was there, throwing bananas and stones, but he died or not. Something happened. Or he was fed up with being on the mountain. Maybe it was too fresh in the morning.
You mean the Swami who was set on the top? They brought him down because he had a big problem with the legs because he was squatting for so many years.
So he could not relax anymore.
And maybe it was
a legs problem.
Maybe like it often is in India, it was the idea of the devotees, and he couldn't do anything against it. So they brought him down to his hometown.
That's why this guy always denied to have devotees and disciples, because devotees and disciples, they fuck you up, I tell you. They make you do things you really don't want. That's how the disciples made for. They want to control the master, and they decide what is the master and who is not, and all of that. You better piss off. Disciples, piss off.
They go out into his home village near Rameshwaram and made an ashram, and he lived there for 5-10 years and long he's dead.
Yeah, you see, when the disciples take care, you die. They take care that you die. Because then they can make a samadhi, they can walk around you. not by your choice, I tell you. Ramana tried several times to escape the ashram and escaping a guru, but they always catched him again. It's true. It's written in the books. It must be true. I, for 15 years, was traveling around the world that no one could follow me because no one had the money for it. But now I'm...
Now you travel with few rich people, it's terrible.
Yeah, you meet rich people and then it's even worse. Then you're always surrounded by rich people. They're the most boring ones. They cannot reach you because they're rich already. Richie. Lionel Richie. My mind is really fucked. Eh? I always have this cross connection somewhere. It's a friend connection. You became an Australian? Oh, yeah. You became an Australian? Ah. I thought you wanted to make a walkabout. Walk about it. This is a talk about it, a walk about it. Good. So, more questions. You see, I never mind questions, and that I don't mind to talk to myself. I can infinitely talk to what I am. And questions are just like an entertainment, like a trigger of an answer. So there's an infinite pool of questions and infinite pool of answers. There's no shortage of questions, for sure not. And no shortage of answers. Because both coming from the same origin. Unexhaustible is what you are. In realizing yourself. And you realize yourself in talking to yourself. Moment by moment. It's a self-talk.
Are there any useful questions?
Yes. What are you doing here?
No. Fucking arseholes. I keep getting up thinking, oh no. No matter what I think, we're bleeding in up there anyway.
So now I have to ask the questions they all have.
It's all right.
What is this guy doing here?
I can irritate myself a lot more. Yes.
You must be bloody English.
Yes. We're not going to be outfought by any German philosophers.
Your English are ruled by Germans anyway.
I know, they're bloody.
English is just a colony of Germany.
They changed their name.
Like, yeah, it's like Mallorca. The island is a bit bigger than Mallorca, but it's ruled by Germans too.
Yeah. And they're all bloody Anglo-Saxons anyway.
That's why they hated the Germans. They cannot get rid of them. Now they have a queen who's the longest time in office forever.
Only because her son's bloody useless.
The son cannot make it anymore.
He talks to trees.
There has to be someone who was born today, maybe. Good.
Trees of Wales.
Spain, come on.
Yes, come on. No idea.
Did you become a Don Quixote or still a bullfighter?
Wow, what a dilemma, eh? Between the two.
Yeah, between Don Quixote and a bullfighter.
Yeah.
You're like a sandwich. What am I, Don Quixote fighting windmills? Or am I a bullfighter fighting bulls? Am I Buddhist or am I Christian? Bullfighter is Buddhist.
Bullfighter is Buddhist?
Yeah, how to tame the bull.
Oh, man, the same tradition, yeah.
Oh, come on.
Come on, yeah.
That's the biggest bullfighter.
Yeah.
Fighting the bull. Taming the bull. Trying to tame the mind, the bull. Always bully.
Yeah.
Always bullying you around.
But it's a good metaphor. It's a very nice metaphor.
Yes?
Yeah.
What was this? It's got something to do with the mountain, huh? First the mountain is not a mountain.
Yeah.
And then you go whatever, and then you come back, and then the mountain again.
Yeah, you come up to simplicity.
So nothing happened.
Yeah.
Simplicity?
Well, yeah. No.
Simplicity for what?
For what it is.
Simple, simple being what you are?
Yeah.
You think it's simple?
I don't know.
Yeah, you say it. I have no idea.
I have no idea.
It can be complicated too. Does it make a difference?
Yeah, it doesn't make any difference, but it's clear.
It's, what is clearer? For who?
I don't know.
But you don't know. But you say simple is better than maybe not simple. Because then you are simple what you are, and simple being what you are is better than complicated what you are. For me, it's being complicated as good as simple. Or bad. You know what you... It's always one is repeating something, what things one is, what is better than something else. So it's like a hearsay, you believe in something what you hear somewhere, which sounded good. Simple is better than not simple. Complicated is bad. If I'm living a complicated life, then it's not so good. If I live a simple life, it's better. Like an advantage of being simple. We just can talk about it. That's all of that is what? Conditioned talala.
Yeah, that's true.
And was it in it? Nothing. And I just want to destroy both things, because you are neither simple or complicated. Neither.
It doesn't matter what we talk. Either
it matters, it matters. Who says it doesn't matter?
I don't know.
You see, you don't know. Why you say it doesn't matter? You can say
because
it makes no difference what we talk. You can say.
For it makes no difference.
There is no difference, but it may matter or not.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah.
Maybe it matters, just in case.
Yes, it does.
Does it matter? Does it matter that it matters?
That's true, yeah.
No, I just asked you.
Huh?
I just point out, you just blah blah. Maybe we have to question what just comes. Like a hearsay out of something. Just like a memory collection of a book written or some teachings and something collection, but then one is spelling out again, like a recorder repeating what someone else had said. And then thinking that is better. Like this perfect, brilliant stillness bullshit. It doesn't need to be brilliant to be what it is, come on. What is bloody brilliant to do with it? Like if a diamond knows to be a diamond, then needs to be brilliant to be a diamond. That I'm hitting, all that bullshit of standards and concepts and making it special. It's so ordinary, how fucking ordinary. He is a symbol of being ordinary and not a brilliant stillness bullshit fighter. But it sells better. And the power of now sells better than the power of later. Then now at least 50 books start with the power of nice, the power of smile, the power of you, the power
power of power.
Americans are just repeating
the power of advertising.
teasing. It's all business. Even the book, The Power of Being Simple. What's wrong with complications? What's wrong with the fucked up mind? Everything, but not more wrong than anything else. I think the more...
more entertaining.
Yeah, it's really unpredictable then. If you know exactly what you are and how you behave, it becomes very, very boring, and you age by it. It's already like being old and know exactly how to react to everything, and every event you already know how to react to it. You never surprise yourself anymore. That's called old age.
Yeah.
And then comes the master, and Jesus said, be it like a child, like a baby. It's unpredictable. You never know what it's crying and why. You think it's hungry, maybe it's something else. Whatever. And the baby doesn't know what it's doing or not, because the baby doesn't know to be a baby. That's why everyone falls in love with a baby, because there's that what is a being, not knowing what is a being. So that is your natural state. Like a baby who doesn't know to be a baby, or not, who doesn't even know father or mother, is just There's one who comes like this, and the other one with some big tit or something, you fuck something. And then you call mama tit and father. That's why they call the ashrams here atiti ashrams, because the sadhus get fat. All India, they are atiti ashrams, so, and they are all feeding the sadhus and things, all like them. And then, where is the Titicacasi lake or something? Wow, titis and beer, they say in England. Huh? Or what about it?
I don't know where you got that from.
Australia, that's Australia.
Is it Australia? Oh, I can imagine that.
Yeah. Because Australia sleeps, I can't see anything now. Titties and beer. But now he's smiling, you see? He said, titties and beer. Because with titties and beer, the Australians get XXXX. Four times X. Then they're gone. The biggest meditation on earth, the bar meditation. And by one drink by drink, you're gone. After whatever, there's a limit, and then you cannot remain that what you believe to be, and then you're gone. And the next moment, you come 10 times more back. But at least for a while, you have this bar meditation, and you are gone for a while. And then when you're gone, everyone around you is gone, and then there's a total friendship. You are friend with everyone. Wow, wonderful. I love you.
Oh, I love you. I love you too.
And when you get sober, what did I say? I love you? So, wow. When you go to bed with people you don't really know.
You wake up with people you don't even recognize.
And then you're really... Maybe won't never wake up again. It's not even with you. So good. That was a little intermezzo. So something more from the simple Spanish pain.
Well, I'm exhausting on my mind.
Exhausting.
Exhausting. Getting exhausted. Thinking of or reflecting on contemplation of.
Yeah, contemplate.
Contemplate. Yeah.
Yeah, contemplate. Just contemplate.
Yeah.
Yesterday we had this, someone who wanted to know what contemplation. Oh, yeah, yeah. When I explained what it's like what it means, contemplation. It's like meditating about and looking through the emptiness, contemplating about what is on your plate, contemplating what is on your plate and what comes out of it. And the direct experiences, you'll know already what comes out of that, what is on your plate. What will become out of that food? The moment you eat it. what comes out of it? Say it.
Shit.
It will be shit. As everything. The same with every information who comes to your stomach up here. Whatever you need, whatever needs to be digested, will be shit. And this body is already decomposed. It's already expired. So what is the destination of this body? Shit. Like going back to its natural state, the shit state. And then out of shit comes another body. So only shit happens. For a while it takes the form of a body, of a human, and then the destination is being decomposed or burned or some whatever, just going to that what is energy, to hit, back to hit. Hit showing itself as shit, a shit factory. But it's still hit, knowledge. That's why it's like that hit and shit. This is the final discrimination is you will never know hit, because you are shit. And you always know yourself as shit. The knower is shit, the knowing is shit, what can be known is shit. That is called Satchitananda. Yeah, there's ananda in there too. It's in happiness that you cannot know yourself. So Satchitananda, but hit. Chit is the nature of sat. Chit is the nature of such it. Even that nature of such and chit is chit. So There is only chit, only the knowledge or the life that what is sat, chit, ananda. But you experience yourself as sat, chit, ananda. You cannot help it. What to do? So enjoy yourself and shit happens. But in that happening, you don't happen, that's all. You're never part of the happening. So be happy, that you don't need to be happy, because that what needs to be happy is part of the happening, happy, 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 and what needs to be happy can be where they are or not, they're happy. It's a P factor. Good. Questions? Otherwise I can allein unterhalten.
How to deal with dislikes?
What life?
Dislike, if you have some...
Dislike?
Yeah, dislike.
But that is permanent. That is permanent.
The person has likes.
You always dislike yourself. Now you try to love yourself. Because you dislike yourself. Actually, when you wake up, every experience of the experiencer is unconditional hate, because the experiencer already hates to exist. So you experience yourself in unconditional hate, in the presence of an experiencer. And whatever is trying to seek a way out of his existence, like you become a seeker of truth or something. He wants to find a way out of his relative existence. So any moment you are a relative experiencer, you hate to exist. So there's an unconditional hate running, permanent. There's no way out. And thanks God you cannot... And then there's another one, the absence of a me, the absence of an experiencer, you can call oneness or whatever. Then there's an unconditional love. Because there is no one. So there's an unconditional hate and unconditional love. And this is the polarity you realize yourself in both ways. And you cannot miss one of them. Of course, both happen when you wake up. There's a presence. That is the trinity of Shiva, actually. It's not like Vishnu. The trinity of Shiva is Shiva, the absolute self, and his presence and his absence. And the preference of Shiva, having a preference of absence, is a me. That's Shiva as a jiva, having a preference of an absence of a jiva. That's called the preference, which is me. And I wake up as the preference itself being Renz. It's my one and only preference. And I hate it any moment, every moment actually. So there's unconditional hate, so what to do? And whatever you try is to make it different. You want to put unconditional love in unconditional hate. It's fantastic. You want to love it all, but you cannot. You always will fail. Because there will always be a tolerance limit, or an acceptance limit. You're unable to accept yourself. And I sit here and tell you, you don't need to accept yourself, come on. You are in unconditional hate as absolute, as in absolute love for yourself. The absolute has to realize itself in absolute every possible way. And this polarity is instantly when you wake up. This polarity of awareness as a personal and an impersonal experience. And the impersonal is always like a preference for that first one. And that preference is an ego, the first I preference. So he wants to get only, he wants to be permanent in oneness or absence in this impersonal experience. Because it's more pleasure, it's like a more peace for that first I. Doubtless existence and doubtless space like spirit, eternal. So the doubtfulness you want to, this doubtful experience of I, this existential fear you want to get rid of. So you try to find a way out. Even Buddha tried in the beginning, the whole time. And he failed. He just admitted, I failed in all possible ways. I didn't find a way out of me being what I am, maybe, or whatever he said. I cannot get out of what I am. And as I realize myself in two absolute ways. In the presence and in the absence. So even the absence is an experience and the presence is an experience, but the absolute experiencer can neither be known in the presence or in the absence. So this the prime nati-nati, I'm not the presence, I'm not the absence. So by not knowing what you are, or you're knowing that what you are not, you are that what just rests in that. But still you cannot stop realizing yourself, because you are the absolute reality, and the realization is not different from what you are. They are not two. You are the nature of realization, because you are the nature of the realizer, the realizing what can be realized. You are that one, it's the heart itself, the absolute heart. But the relative realizer lives himself in unconditional hating that he has to realize himself. He wants to stop realization. And the other one, the absence of an impersonal realizer, is already fine with that, whatever. It's the perfect love affair of impersonal love, unconditional love, and the love affair of a conditioned love. And that is called unconditional hating, that is conditioned, because you only have a preference of unconditional love, that you love yourself in any way. But in this way you cannot do it. So there are two different ways, and you cannot get rid of any of them, because they are only there because you are. And you cannot miss any aspect of your infinite nature. And hating is as much an aspect of what you are as loving. So there's loving and hating. And does it make you more or less? That's the main question. Does your nature get more or less by whatever you imagine? Now you imagine that loving is better than hating, because in hating I feel not so good. But who is not feeling good in it? Me again. And the me never feels good, because the me, the nature of the me, is misery. Misery and misery and all that stinginess, whatever comes with this me and mine and yours and all that. So even if you would be the owner of the universe, it would be not enough. It would not satisfy you. There is no satisfaction in ownership. Because you know by heart, whatever you can own is shit. Fantastic. You know it by absolute intuition. In any ownership, there's ownership. And the ship will sink down again. And you're the captain of the Titanic. As the biggest titan of knowledge you can become, you will be sink into that knowledge again where you came from. So you don't have to do even anything. There will be an iceberg in front of you, and you will be crushed. So you're all crash test dummies, just for existence, being produced to crash again.
I was saying the saints.
The saint is a looking better crash test dummy. But still a crash test dummy, because he will be crushed too. God will cut down whatever he produced. Shiva will destroy whatever he created. What can he do? This is two sides. He creates to destroy. Because creating and destroying is no different. Creating is destroying that what was there before. So. Italy. Something from Italy. No? All fine in Italy? Is Mariella coming soon?
Today.
Today, ah, you see, what is in my... It was by intuition. Huh? He arrived already?
Yes.
Ah, is that why she came into this?
Your mind.
Into my, whatever you call it. Or something from...
No, I don't have any questions. If I did, I'd ask them.
Okay. Yeah.
Everything you're saying just what to do?
What to do? Yeah, that's actually you sit everywhere and just in case and what to do.
I like the just in case. Because you never know.
You never know.
You never know.
Just in case. Maybe there is something to realize. You never know. Just in case. But that's fun, just in case. You go to the cinema just in case there's a good movie.
Yeah.
Just in case. You will be disappointed anyway, but just in case. And I tell you, being disappointed is the best. Being absolutely disappointed by yourself. Because the self can never satisfy you. Because all it is a self is an imaginary one. Fantastic.
Ah, yeah. That reminds me, Voltaire, the famous French philosopher, when he was lying on his deathbed.
Voltaire, I mean, it's a nice name, like, give me more voltage.
Yeah.
Voltaire.
He was a big rationalist and atheist, no? When he was lying on his deathbed, he was lying. Of course, the relatives, they brought in the Catholic priest, and he was doing his stuff. And then in the end, the priest asked Voltaire, do you renounce the devil and all his evil ways? And Voltaire answered, I think this is not a good time to make enemies, no?
Yeah. Just in case. You never know what the next landlord is, huh? And maybe it's a gay lord or a landlord. Everyone is wishing for a gay lord. A gay landlord. So in India they already know that God is gay. Good. England, something more? You're from where in England? From London?
No, Oxford.
Oxford. Well known for its university. Where the oxes are fought. Where the science are working on science fiction. Because whatever can be found out is science fiction, because it comes from a scientist. And whatever a scientist finds out has to be science fiction. When the good scientists now admit we cannot know the nature of energy, the nature of mind, then we call it God particle, but they just call it something. But now they admit, and all this quantum physics will see, it can never be known, it will always change, they become Buddhists these days. Because they failed being a scientist. So they're trying to find the God in the matter, whatever, they think we cannot even find matter, so there is not even something in matter, because we cannot find matter. So it may not matter. So the next doesn't matter, has happened. Good. Germany. Nada de nada. Yeah?
Trying to get a sense of how would you describe how to approach life then? Is it, I'm getting a sense that it's just simple acceptance of everything, whatever it is.
No, accept the closest to whatever that you can accept that you can never accept.
Accept that you can never accept.
That's the end of your possibilities. That to know that you will never know, to accept that you will never accept. That's the closest of what understanding can bring you. But that's final, because after that there is no... This is like the end of your possibilities and what you can approach, that state that you know you will not know. To accept that you will never accept. And this is the end of intellect, the end of your way, the end of whatever, but the end, maybe after that end is not the end of what you are. But this is the end of the phantom spirit. You can, by understanding, maybe understand, or the intellect to understand, and trying to cut itself, but it will never cut itself. Understanding that the poison of the intellect cannot kill the intellect. The snake cannot kill the snake. As much as you bite into what you are, you cannot be killed by your own poison. So the knower cannot be killed by his own knowledge. And then the Buddhists say you have to be a free heart and wisdom together. Because then you get killed by love. Love kills wisdom, and wisdom kills love. Because both are disappearing in that crazy wisdom of heart. And crazy wisdom is just a pointer to that to be heart which never knows or doesn't know what it is and what it is not. This craziness of no direction in anything. The wisdom of wisdom. Being the heart of wisdom, not knowing any wisdom. Not having any wisdom. Where there is no ownership in anything. When you are that, that is Nisargadatta's I am that. Not calling it anything. Just I am that. But neither has name or not name. You will never frame it. But you are that. And I am that. And that is that. So, what to do? Just a pointer. Like a paradox, a permanent paradox, that you're absolute contradiction in it yourself. You know absolutely that you are, but now you try to know it even relatively, and that doesn't work. So even to claim that you don't know, you have to exist. And that existence is knowledge. So the knowledge that you are is uninterrupted. So even now that you may claim not to know, you have to know. And especially you have to know what you don't know, that you cannot know it. It's amazing, right? Yeah. Even if you say, I don't know, you have to know what you don't know. So there's always knowledge. Even if you claim that you don't know, you know. So even if you say, I have no idea, you have to have an idea of what you have not an idea of. So you claim, you do as if you don't know, but it doesn't work. Outside, the beginning of a wonderful love affair. No, shit. Just in case. Anything can happen. So I don't buy it. If someone comes to me, I don't know, I don't buy it. I always put him on the pot and tell him, come on.
Shit.
Shit, no. And I don't mind to be an absolute toilet, because whoever comes with all this shit, I just take it. I don't mind to be full of shit. Or being a fool of shit.
It has no weight. Shit
is wonderful because you don't mind when it goes. This precious understanding, this precious pearls of understanding, you have to remind yourself all the time, you have to remember them, you have to polish them, you have to do something. That's really shitty. And you really believe you have some, you found something, and now you have to polish it. Especially when you're not from Poland. Because for Poland people, to be polished is natural, but for Germans... I never understood Prabhupada when he told people, now I gave you the pearl of understanding or of an insight, now you have to take care and polish it every moment. And that's like a point of failing, because they all failed. All of them failed. After a while, by whatever, they stopped something you could not remind, so the whole experience down the drain again. And then they had to have the same pearl again. So I don't doubt Papadi or something, but he gave him the impossibility as a pointer. I gave you the pearl, and now you try to keep it. And every one of them failed. And failing is the best. Seeing that your helplessness is running everywhere. You cannot keep anything. Everything what came will be gone one day. And still you will be what you are. In spite of coming and going, you are. So what? So all the fleeting shadows of pearls or treasures or ideas or big understandings, Okay. They have nothing to offer. They are totally empty. And just in case, sometimes you look at them and think, okay, bye-bye. Like, oh, yo, just in case, okay, bye-bye. Just have fun as looking into it, but not expecting is being more expecting. You just look, just in case you do something, you know, look into it, maybe. Okay, maybe not. No, the main thing is your so-called treasure you are, the quality of life, never gets more or less by anything. It has no quantity issue. It never has any limits of high or low or anything. It doesn't know even what is high and what is low and what is distance and what is limit and all of that. All of that only appears in dream. But the quality is not knowing any quality of life or knowing life at all. So treasuring yourself is being that but absolutely doesn't know what to treasure, because there's nothing to treasure. By being what is a treasure, you don't know any treasure. So there's nothing to treasure anymore, and you treasure yourself more by not knowing yourself. So by not knowing yourself, what you are and what you're not, this is treasuring absolutely what you are. By being the treasure who never needs to be treasured by anything or by anyone. So what's there to... And then people ask me, why are you still sitting somewhere and talking about what no one needs? I said, oh, just in case.
It's in the contract.
Just in case. Who knows? And talking to myself, I enjoy it. Talking eye to eye to what I am, there's no more joy in talking to yourself. Unexhaustible. It's never enough, and never too much or too less. It's just exactly as it is. Talking to what I am, in this so-called meeting myself in an impossibility of meeting, because I will never meet myself, but just in case. That's why I never understood satsang, meeting of truth. I have no idea. Some meeting, embodiment of what? Of ignorance, meeting somewhere. I enjoy the ignorance, because I am the ignorance. Because I don't need to know myself, to be myself. Oh, good.
Finished early then?
Early, half an hour, come on. Don't show any tiredness. Come on, just in case.
I thought we were all there.
Just in case, yes.
But we were wallowing in it.
I do not talk to yourself, to you. He is absolute, God is talking to absolute. That is what you are telling.
No, I didn't say that. Absolute never says anything.
Now
I am here.
Okay.
I enjoy to experience myself as a relative speaker, talking to relative listeners. And there's nothing in it.
That was your statement a few times.
Which one? The absolute never talks to anyone.
Yeah, this is exactly the question which I wanted to ask.
The absolute experiencing himself as a talker and the listener, but it's never the talker or the listener. So the absolute never says anything, but it says everything. It is everything, or nothing, or whatever, but it never says anything. But still it says everything. So yes and no. Does silence speak? Uninterrupted. But does silence say something by that? No. So it's a permanent paradox. So that what is silence? Realizing itself and all that what you can, but pronouncing itself and whatever can be pronounced, but itself stays at that what cannot be pronounced itself. The absolute pronouncer which cannot not be found but is pronounced. But that what is pronounced is not different from that what is pronouncing it. So the absolute dreamer, dreaming an absolute dream, and The relative dreamer is part of the dream, but you cannot make a difference between the relative dreamer and the after dreamer, because the nature of the relative dreamer is the after dreamer. So is he saying or not saying something? Who makes a difference to say the absolute doesn't say anything and the relative says? Who makes a difference?
You.
No, I don't think it. I am as absolute as relative, as absolute as not relative. You want to nail me down. You try the best to nail me down, but you will not succeed. You know that.
I never did it.
I know that the eaves of all time, come on, bite in this apple. Is there someone who is biting? Do you exist? Come on, I do it first for you, then you don't feel that. I know this evolution.
You did it.
And then in all Israel, they blaming Adam that he was biting in the wrong, choosing the wrong tree. Always being blamed. Why didn't you choose the tree of life? And why did you choose the tree of knowledge? Now we all have to seek the bloody truth. Amazing, huh? All Israel is blaming Adam. He is so damned. Why? If he would have chosen the right tree. Amazing. I like all religions because they don't lead to anything. And I always ask, would Christ would be Christian these days? What would you say? Would Christ join Christianity?
No.
Absolutely not. Would Buddha be Buddhist? Absolutely not. Because whatever comes out of that guys is used against them or something. It's just like the opposite what they said. Always the opposite. And Ramana the same, he's not an exception. Now it becomes Ramanism, another religion. Around the world, it's amazing, huh? Everywhere you go, you find Ramana devotees, Ramana disciples. I am in the lineage of Ramana, of the guy who never had any lineage, who said there is no lineage of the self. But now there are infinite people who claim I am in the lineage of Ramana, giving satsang even, or doing in the name of Ramana, who never gave any confirmation to anyone, not even to himself. But now they claim to be confirmed by Papaji, by Ramana, in the lineage of something. It's a shit lineage. Because they're only lineages in shit, in ignorance, because the self has no lineage. So what to do? To let some be just in case, it's a nice shit lineage. Diksha, Shaktipas, all that ideas, what to do with it? Just in case too. There's something like Tom, Dick and Harry.
Is it easy to fool myself?
It's impossible not to fool yourself. It's not only easy, it's impossible not to fool yourself. You will always be fooled by what you are. And you are the absolute fool for yourself. And you cannot stop it. And the biggest thing is, you will always fall in love with an image of what you are. You cannot stop it. Love makes you the biggest fool for yourself. And you cannot stop loving yourself. So this love for yourself will never stop. Final. Just in case.
When I come to the stage.
You come to the stage?
When there is a why not?
It's all. It's not a stage, it's just.
Yeah, I don't know how to call it. When there is this why not, is it maybe a trick? Did I trick myself? Did I try to care again about a why not?
Why not? Then you say why not? Why not another trick? Because always the absolute trickster who has infinite tricks to trick yourself. You will fool yourself if you like it or not. The biggest fools are the people who think, now I cannot be fooled anymore. I know all the tricks. Ha ha. That's the biggest trick. Now I know all the traps and I will not step into any trap anymore. That's the biggest trap. Not stepping into the next trap. That's the biggest trap. Because then you believe you made it. That trap is very big.
So it's infinite fooling.
Who cares about being fooled by oneself? You are the king and the fool, and you must be joking. Even by believing that you are the king, you must be joking. It's already an imaginary king of an imaginary kingdom. You must be joking, but you're fooled by your own idea that you can rule the kingdom of heart. Oh my goodness. King doomed, I would say. The moment you are the king, you are a doomed king. A king doomed by an idea that you can ever rule yourself. The kingdom of heart. You are heart, but you don't know what is and what is not heart. Heart doesn't know heart, and heart doesn't have heart. And the king has a kingdom, and that is his biggest trap. Doomed by ownership. My heart, just in case I have one. So what's better, having or not having heart? Both is false. But again, I rather have no heart or not. Just in case I have no heart, when the no heart cannot be broken. It's a very famous technique around the world. After a while, after many times broken heart, you say, better have no heart. Then you make, I'm a no me, I'm a no heart. Then I cannot be touched, I cannot be hurt anymore. Fantastic. But that's the biggest foolish thing. I heard. Being beyond suffering. Good. Something more from the just in case questions. Germany. Tired today, eh?
Can I have a cookie?
You feel weak?
No.
Help. It's like help yourself. Where did it come from? Says, but I sit here and tell you there's not even a help who can help you. So what to do? There's no help. Neither to for anything. So if there's someone again who wants to help you, you cry for help. If someone wants to help me, help, help. He cannot even help himself. He wants to help me. That's just like this satsang teachers. They want to help people. Oh, he cannot even help himself. What did they say? If there's someone left and the universe left, you need to help, then for sure you are not that what is reality. So if you're Eckhart Tolle and you want to make a new world, you need some help. Just in case. He sees a world who needs to be changed and transformed into a higher level of consciousness. Fantastic. Huh? I'm always impressed that the biggest teachers of our times are still in this fascistic way. Little Nazis, little Hitlers who want to change the world. Wow. But if I say it, then I can say as a German, I know Nazis. And he is German too, so I know what is there. Even if he is sitting with a maximum pigmented lady somewhere. In Switzerland, they call now black people maximum pigmented persons. If that is not fashion and discriminating, what is? What are we? Pigmented. Even the word pigmented is like a pig, meant to be a pig or what? Pigmented. So, something from... You're from Maham? Sorry, Jane, or I saw something. And it's still good running?
Pardon?
It's an ashram, well, whatever. Fun,
just in case.
Just in case. No, I like that. It's like the Ramanashram, it's just in case. All just in case. Because you are so nuts for yourself, you're a nutcase anyway, and then just in case you make it.
Like, nutcase,
yeah. Yeah, you are a nutcase.
Nutcase.
A nutcase is meeting. Cracking nuts who never needs to be cracked. Like a nutcracker. Cracks. But no question. But what I say is okay or? No. Well, just in case. I hope I contradicted myself enough. Not really.
I heard you were really, really, really tough.
Tough? I'm not tough. They all complain now. They all complain now. Carl was, once he was tough, now he become
tough.
It's really disappointing.
I know.
I'm too lazy now to be tough. Shit, I became too lazy to be tough.
We enjoy the dragon in the gate.
Yeah, becomes a pussycat. What's new, pussycat?
Why not?
No, someone asked me last year the same question, like, why are you so, it seems to be much softer than before. I said, now the sword maybe is sharper. I don't need to hit like a hammer. I cut from within. I don't have to open the egg from outside, I just cut the chicken inside before it's even born. No, if you ask me, it's more like when I talk directly, I don't have to crack anything. But I think 15 years ago, sitting on rooftops here, I was still a sledgehammer, kind of, from outside, trying to crack and destroying something. And now I'm even destroying the destroying. So I'm more like the softness who is killing everything by just being soft. It's more dangerous. It's absolutely more dangerous than that's...
It's like quicksand.
Yeah, it's like a quicksand. You can, as more as you try to get out of it, you sink into it. Like the Buddha, like what's called out of the mud, like where you sink into the Everglades. That's why they're called Everglade. It's called Florida. You step in and then you sink, and you, whatever you sink, Everglade.
The more you fight it.
The more you fight, you sink into the what is ever glad, what is glad forever. Some try to go to the Mount Everest, like going to the Himalaya, where the Layas meet, and sitting in front of a cave and lying to himself, to be alone is better than being in the world. That's why it's called Himalaya.
I don't quite understand when you said kill it.
Kill what?
Kill it, or the chicken and the egg, or doing
something. No, you kill the, you I, it's
kill
like kill, killing the idea that you can die.
Could you explain that a bit more?
Yeah, I put you around death, I kill everything, what is your, whatever you're holding on to, whatever your idea of life and thing. And that you can ever escape what you are, and by killing this, making it an absolute no way out, because in that no one can exist. You can only exist as a relative me in the hope one day it will be over. Or I can do something, or something will happen. So just in case you do, because you believe there will be a final moment of your life. Mm-hmm. But I show you maybe, there is no final. There will always be the next sip of coffee, like the next moment of realizing yourself. So death is not the end, as birth was not the beginning of what you are. So you're already there before even the experience of birth could happen. You have to be there. Otherwise there's no one who can be born. If that one would not be already there, you could not be born. So it has already to be there as what you are, that you have an experience of birth. But you still are that what is in that experience not born, because you were already there. So in birth, life is not starting. So the life you are is not starting in being born. It will not end when that happens. So two extreme events would now make you different as you are. So you're between sandwiched by the idea of birth and death. And just two ideas you are impressed by. Because you believe now, you committed in a way suicide. By believing that you're born and now you have a shit factory as a home, you committed suicide in a way, because you left the absolute life for some relative idea. And all you want and now you want to get out of it. And I show you there is no way out of it. Because you didn't go in the first place. So if you really would be born and being born, there would be maybe a way of being eternal, like you could prolong your life and do something, long living. But as you were not born in the first place, you cannot die. So I go first to the, when the beginning, there was no beginning for you. And the end, there will be no end. But the little me can only live in the beginning and an end. So I destroy both. And I go to the beginning and show you in the beginning there was no beginning. And there will be no end in the end. But if I go from now that you are born now, and I would confirm that, and would teach you something, now you can do something, I would confirm that you are born, and there will be an end by whatever teaching. So whatever I teach them is confirming your relative existence. So I destroy that, by just showing you that you already are there before birth happens. That birth experience can only happen because that experience that you are in your nature was already there, otherwise there could not be an experience of birth. And you will be there even after the experience of death. And as you are now there, uninterrupted. That's all. So and that can never get more or less, because you, as you didn't get more by being born, you will not be less by the experience of death, and this goes again. So this shit factory happened, and it will be gone. Sooner or later, but who cares when? Because when this is gone, something else will happen. Whatever it will be. But it's still, like now, you are unaffected by this so-called presence. You will be not affected by the next presence. The presence will always be the presence. And in spite of the presence or absence, you are. So you are that what is Shiva in this trinity of experiencing itself in presence and in absence. So two phases on Shiva, the known and the unknown. But Shiva himself is never known or unknown. It's the absolute knower who knows himself in known and he knows himself in not knowing. So it's that absolute existence is, which is in knowing and in not knowing, in presence and in absence, what it is. That's the only way out of the idea that there is a way out. So it's a permanent paradox. The problem is that there was never any problem for what you are. That's the biggest problem. You cannot find any problem for what you are. But you make something up. You imagine one. And I always tell this so little whatever mind, don't worry. There's problem that there was never any problem. There's always been there. So don't worry. Well, worry and be happy. Whatever, because there's nothing to fear, because no one wants you to go. Because you're not even there now. What is there to do? Having another mess. So but that why when I talk to what I am, and I can only destroy that you become or that showing you you're the substratum by nature. The abstract itself. It can never be abstracted by anything. But you, as the abstract, by being what you are, abstract everything in one instant. By being the substratum, that absolute leftover, when everything goes, every night, you still exist. And every morning, every night, your experiences are in absence. And every morning comes presence again. So you are in the absence and presence. So if you would be not, if you are something what needs a presence, you should not exist in the absence, in deep, deep sleep. But you still are, as you are now, in the presence of this dream. So you're to know yourself, which is in the absence, as in the presence, uninterrupted, unaffected. But none of that has any consequence for what you are. No consequence in any presence or absence. Never more or less as you are. But the absolute consequence out of it, you cannot leave what you are. No way out. You are that, which is, people would call it whatever, it's called reality. Reality would not call itself reality, but just for the sake of speaking. We call it reality, and reality now is realizing itself. But it's called realization. So it's a realization. So you experience yourself in lies. That's what lila. Because as what you are, you cannot experience yourself. Parabrahman cannot know himself. So whatever he can know himself as is in lies. The liar, the lying, and what can be lied about? The Brahman, whatever the creator is creating is a lie, because only the creator is a lie. Because it has no own existence. It's an imaginary creator, an imaginary creation. So the only reality is that what you are, but that you will never know. You can only be it. Because there is no knower possible in that knowledge. The knower the knower has to stay in the lies. You have to be in spite of the knower what you are. So the act of not knowing of what you are is just a pointer to the nature of knowledge. And to be that is to be knowledge, but not to have it. It will be never my knowledge or your knowledge. So that this guy, whoever said, if you could just drop the mind, it would be fine. But who can drop the mind? Big problem. Huh? How can the owner drop the owner? Impossible. It will, every night you drop him as nothing, a hot potato, and every morning you pick him up again. Just in case. There's something in the potato. Okay, I give you one day more, just in case. Maybe today he will make something, but still you are not pleased that night, so you fall asleep. Well, maybe then the next day, full of hope, maybe today, just in case, give a little attention. Maybe today, when he goes to meditation, maybe today he will make it. Let him close his eyes. Let him go down deep in the silence, what he calls silence, and then let's see when he comes up or how he's in. Sounds good. It's an uninterrupted enjoyment. That what is joy cannot not enjoy itself. So it enjoys itself in hating and loving and good and bad, and there's an enjoyment which is uninterrupted. Especially when in front of that there is a miserable seeker who is doesn't want to live anymore. Look, today he really doesn't want to live anymore. Let's see what he comes up with. What is his idea today? How will he kill himself today? Will he try to meditate himself to death? Or eat himself to death? Or drink too much chai or something? Or running around the mountain and being bitten by a snake or something? Let's see what he will try today. If he would say something. But there's always this lazy bastard in the back, this whatever, what you are, always enjoying the deepest despair, the deepest depression of any whatever shit factory in front of you. Look how the shit factory feels today. It really feels like shit today. Oh, he feels so sick today. Oh, the sicker feels sick today. Oh, how sick can you feel? Are there limits? Come on, a bit deeper. So, and I always say then, you better enjoy yourself. Because if you don't enjoy yourself, there is no other self who enjoys you. And it will take a while. You cannot imagine how long it will take.
No, so I don't get that. It takes a while to enjoy yourself.
No, it will take a while. Reality realizing itself, as it never started to realize itself, it will never end. So it will take a while. You cannot imagine how long, but it will take a while. Okay. Meanwhile, just in case, of course it will take a while anyway, so meanwhile, just in case, you try something else. You try to kill yourself, you eat all the junk food, or you eat healthy, that's worse. Because if you eat healthy, you see hell already. You must be sick to eat healthy. I have many friends now, I come into this age, they regret that they were eating organic all life. Because I have many friends, they enjoyed life by eating all and drinking and smoking. They're dying daily now. They're all in the dying and they all go to funerals and say hello. And all the organic people, they hate it now. Because they have to live at least 10 years longer. So they're really envy and being jealous about the one who lived his life just drinking, eating meat and going out and whatever, smoking.
Pesticides.
Whatever, pesticides and things and living on a whatever, where all that junk food, eating McDonald's and just enjoying all that junk. Because it's all junk anyway. But now the organic people, they have to eat 10 years more organic. They didn't enjoy it before, and then they don't enjoy it now, because it's very expensive, especially for seekers. for stingy, mice seekers is really hard. Paying 3 times, 4 times, 5 times more than the other ones who buy in the supermarket, and the cheapest place, and they pay 5 times more, and it hurts. It's a permanent pain, because you have to pay more than your collect. Or whatever, your comrades who just eat junk and feel good. And you eat all the organic things and you're all those stingy mice, and by that mind fuck you get so sick.
I get all that good people which feel good in treatment.
You got it, you get them. If you're an organic person, she heals you.
All people who feel good.
Mm-hmm. Who are they?
You told when you eat unorganic garbage you feel good. So I got that.
So at least you enjoy feeling bad.
Yeah, for true.
You will not feel better than the other one, but you at least you know why you don't feel good.
Yes.
But if you eat organic all the time and you still feel shit, then it's really you tried all the best to be healthy and organic, and you already thought on the worms when you're dead that the worms have some good meat. I like it, it's all fair. The one who wants to be special and specially healthy is specially sick. For sure.
Well, now I write that organic food is not really organic.
Oh, for sure, in America for sure not. And in Germany not, everywhere. It's just an idea too. If you ask me, what is not organic in that way?
Because you had to have turned your for 10 years in order to get pesticides out.
20 years no spraying, and who has so much money to leave it alone for that time? It's all business, business.
Now it's too much.
Too much? Too long, yeah.
Too long, yes.
Too much, too long. No, we are still too much. I have to be German. 2 minutes more. One question. So. Enjoy the.
Yeah.
No, I finally enjoy that you don't need to enjoy anything. That's the joy. The nature of joy never needs to enjoy anything to be what it is. So enjoy to be that what doesn't need to enjoy anything. And be that what can never be sick at all. And never needs to be healthy. The rest is fiction anyway. Absolute fiction. And so don't be fiction, be that what is not fiction. Because whatever you can experience, whatever you can know is fiction. But that you can know fiction, you have to be. So be that what knows everything as fiction, even that it knows everything is fiction. Even knowing everything is fiction. So there's nothing is excluded. Yeah. All is included in fiction. That's called consciousness, because consciousness is fiction. And that's all there is consciousness. And all of that is fiction. And all of that cannot make you or unmake you. Fantastic. Huh? Fiction or not? Crucifixion!
So there's no such thing as non-fiction.
Please?
There's no such thing as non-fiction.
Non-fiction is as fiction as fiction. Fiction, fiction, fiction. That voice called be that what is satisfaction. Not satisfiction. Because the sat you can experience is fiction. The sat you are, you can deny it or not to be. You have to be that what can deny itself. That you, by denying to be that, you are that. You cannot not be it, that's all. So be what you cannot not be. That's the only point I give, actually. Be what you cannot not be. The rest is fiction anyway. Good. So if I don't see you anymore...
The best of British values to you.
Bon appétit.
Thank you.
I would say welcome back home, back home. If I'm successful, I'll never see you again. But I have no hope.